Well, this talk, welcome back. This talk will be a joint talk given by one person. So it's a joint talk by Fabrizio Andreatta, Adriano Iovita, and Vincent Piloni, who have had the kindness of writing down their affiliations on their first page, so I don't have to say them aloud. So without saying anything else, I will just give, well, let the man speak.
Okay, so this is a joint invitation with Fabrizio Andreatta from the University of Milano and Adriano Iovita from Concordia University and Padova. Okay, and I would like to take the opportunity to thank them for all this, the work we did over the years, and for trusting in my capacity to give this talk. Okay, so let me start with a very influential conjecture in our domain, so which is part of the Langlands program. And so this conjecture is the following. So you take K, a number field, you choose a positive integer n, and you fix an isomorphism between C and QP bar. So QP bar is an algebraic closure of QP. And so the conjecture states the existence of a bijection between two sets. So the first set is the set of cuspidal algebraic automorphic forms on the group GLN over K. And the second set is the set of irreducible geometric Galois representations, so representations from the Galois group of K bar over K into GLN of QP bar. And this bijection should respect the L functions you can attach to both these objects. So let me maybe say a little bit what are actually these two sets. Okay, and as you will see, they are of very different nature. So cuspidal algebraic automorphic forms on the group GLN over K, they are certain smooth functions on GLN of the adels of K divided by GLN of K with value in C. Okay, so if you don't know what are the adels of K, I mean, let's just assume that K is equal to Q, the field of rational number, and I could equally say that these are certain smooth functions on the space of lattices in R to the N, maybe endowed with some level structure. So choose some points, some torsion points in the lattice also. This is one set. And the algebraic condition is a condition that actually this smooth function should satisfy certain differential equations with integral coefficients. Okay, so it's again a transcendental condition. So you see, I mean, it's an analytic condition. So you see, this set is really a set of analytic nature. Okay, it belongs to functional analysis and representation theory over the complexes. Below, we have this set of irreducible geometric representations of the absolute Galois group of K. There is this word geometric. So what does it mean? It means that the Galois representations have to be continuous. Okay, I mean, there's a topology on both sides, so they have to be continuous. They have to be unramified at almost finite primes, okay? And there is a very subtle but important condition coming from Piatti-Koch theory. But you see, they are termed geometric because it is actually conjectured that these representations are exactly the ones that you will find in the etal cohomology of algebraic varieties defined over K, okay? So therefore, this set is really of arithmetic nature, okay? One of the reasons we are actually, I mean, interested in this conjecture is because, I have a technical problem. So I cannot go to the next slide. Okay, so maybe. Yeah. Okay, well, that was all. Thank you. No, I mean, I can make some. I can. No, I don't dare to do this. Oh, yeah. Then, So, okay, very good. Okay, sorry. So now, I mean, you see, so yes, so one of the reasons we are interested in this conjecture, which is maybe, I mean, a bit heavy to cite, I mean, even to state, sorry, is because it would solve an even older conjecture and maybe more down to earth, which is the Hassevelle conjecture. It is a conjecture about the zeta functions of algebraic varieties defined over K. So you see, let's take X to be some proper algebraic variety, proper smooth, say, algebraic variety X defined over K, and so we can construct its zeta function. So how do we construct it? Well, we take some model of this algebraic variety, say, Gothic X over the ring of integers of K, and we look at its points over finite fields. And using this, one can build some Euler product, okay, in finite Euler product, and this will give us the zeta function. So of course, if the field K is just the field of rational number Q, and if we take X to be the trivial variety, so just the point over Q, then we get the Riemann zeta function. So in some sense, these zeta functions are a wild generalization of the Riemann zeta function. Okay, and now you see, well, there is first a cohomological interpretation of this zeta function, which allows us to rewrite it in terms of the etal cohomology groups of X. Okay, this formula, so I mean, this is Grothendieck's cohomological interpretation. And then if you believe the conjecture I just stated, then you can actually write this, I mean, it would have an automorphic expression, okay? So using automorphic forms on different, I mean, for different ends. Okay, and because of the known properties of automorphic L series, then we would get the meromorphic continuation. So sorry, it should not be analytic, it's meromorphic continuation and the functional equation of this zeta function. Okay, all right. So, and of course, the most emblematic example where this was applied is this theorem of Weiss, Breuil, Conrad, Diamond, and Taylor, which says that if you take an elliptic curve, or a genus one curve, say X over Q, then the zeta function has indeed this automorphic expression where you have on the top the zeta function, the classical zeta function, which is also the L series as attached to the trivial automorphic form. And on the bottom, you have a weight two modular form, which corresponds to some automorphic form on the group GL2 over Q. Okay. So now you see the bijection we are looking for is a bijection between two, at least conjecturally, countable sets. But it's very useful and to try to undo these sets with more structures. And so a fundamental and classical idea in our field is to actually introduce a p-adic topology on both sides and study this conjectural correspondence with this p-adic topology, with the help of this p-adic topology. So first, on the set of Galois representations, well, they are valued in GLn of QP bar, and QP bar has the p-adic topology. I mean, and so therefore, this set has naturally the p-adic topology. Okay, two Galois representations are close to each other if the matrices of Frobenius, of elements in the Galois group, are close to each other in the p-adic topology. Okay. Now we consider the second set. So the second set is more subtle because, as I told you, it is really of transcendental nature, just by definition. So the first thing, if you want to even speak about any p-adic topology, is to prove some algebraicity statement about this set. And the technique we have to prove algebraicity is actually to incarnate these algebraic automorphic forms, if this is possible, in some cohomology, which could be either the cohomology of a vector bundle on a variety, an algebraic variety defined over a number field, or the Betti cohomology of some manifold. And then eventually study the p-adic variation of this realization. So, I mean, in this talk and in our work, we've been concerned with the coherent cohomology realization, so the cohomology of the vector bundles. And I must say that there are lots of works in other directions, but somehow I don't have time to even speak about them. So I'm okay. So the algebraic varieties we are going to consider are Shimura varieties. So Shimura varieties are locally symmetric spaces, so actually they are quotients by arithmetic groups of symmetric spaces, but they have a very special property. It is that they have an algebraic structure, okay? And they can be defined over number fields. I will give an example in a second, okay? And then we can look at the cohomology groups. So we look at the cohomology groups of the Shimura variety. So let's assume that the Shimura variety is proper. I mean, otherwise, there's a theory of compactification. So we can look at these cohomology groups with value in the automorphic vector bundles. So what are the automorphic vector bundles? There are some vector bundles that you can naturally construct on these locally symmetric spaces because they have so many symmetries and properties that somehow there's an abundance of such bundles. So if you look at these cohomology groups over the complexes, then actually it has been understood that to a very large extent they can be computed using automorphic forms. Okay? On the other hand, this cohomology, well, since the Shimura variety is defined over a number field, then these cohomology are finite dimensional over Q. And so this is how you can get an algebraic structure. Okay? So before I go further, I should say, I mean, that there are many interesting algebraic automorphic forms that we don't know how to study by this method. Okay? For example, mass forms, but okay. So somehow this is a very interesting question, but okay. So we do what we can. Okay. And so what I will explain in this talk is how we can study the p-adic properties of this cohomology. Okay. So let me actually specialize everything to some example. So, I mean, it's a fundamental example of a Shimura variety. So I will take my Shimura variety to be the Ziegle Shimura variety. So it has a modular interpretation. It is the moduli of abelian varieties of dimension g. So g is a fixed integer with some level structure. So the level structure is fixed and some polarization whose degree you fix also. Okay. So over the Shimura variety, I have to explain to you how you can construct the automorphic vector bundles. So, you see, first, you have a universal abelian variety, a tautological object over it, okay, like in the talk of this morning with the moduli of curves, okay? And associated to this universal abelian variety, you have a locally free sheaf of rank G, which is the sheaf of differentials. And therefore, you can construct a functor that goes from representations, the finite dimensional representations of GLG toward vector bundles of the Shimura variety that we will call automorphic sheaves or automorphic vector bundle. And what you do is that you twist your sheaf of your locally free sheaf of differential forms by this representation under the action of GLG. Okay? So actually it will be convenient for me to label the reducible representations of GLG by dominant characters of a maximal torus, okay? So these dominant characters, I mean, I will denote them as usual. I mean, so a character is given by a tuple of integers, k1 until kg, and for some choice of Borel, the dominant ones are k1 greater than k2, etc., greater than kg, okay? So this is a cone inside the lattice. Okay, and now for each such dominant character, I denote by V of kappa, so dominant character kappa, I denote by V of kappa the automorphic sheaf. I will think of kappa as being the weight of my automorphic sheaf, and this is coherent with what you know. I mean, you may maybe know what is a modular form of weight k. And, well, a modular form of weight k is a section of the weight k automorphic sheaf over a modular curve. Okay? So, okay, so now, I mean, what I want to explain now is how you can actually p-adically vary these automorphic sheaves, okay? So first of all, you see these automorphic sheaves, they are parameterized by certain algebraic characters. And therefore, I first have to find a parameter space that contains these algebraic characters, okay? And this parameter space will be like the natural base over which I can vary the automorphic sheaves. So this parameter space is called the p-adic weight space. So you see, the weights, they are characters of the group gm to the g, the maximal torus inside GLG. But this group is very rigid. It has few characters. I mean, it has contably many, but... So, recall, I fix a prime P and somehow I work over p-adic basis. So the idea, the first idea, which is very classical, for, is to replace this group gm to the g by a profinite subgroup which sits in it. And this profinite subgroup is the group zp star to the g. And now one can look at the space of continuous characters of zp star to the g. This is our white space. And this space has a very nice structure of analytic variety over qp. Namely, it is a finite union of g-dimensional open ball. So why is this? Let's assume that g is equal to 1. Okay, so the group zp star is the product of a finite group and a topology, a group which is isomorphic to zp, so it is topologically free. And then the weight space is a disjoint union of open balls of radius 1. So you first get a discrete invariant for the characters. This is the value on the finite part of zp star. And then you get a continuous invariant in this open unit disk, and this is the value of the character over a topological generator of the free part. Okay. And of course, each algebraic dominant character, you can restrict it to zp star, and that way you get a point on your weight space. And these points are what we call classical weights or classical points. Okay. And it's important to notice that classical points are Zariski dense in W. Okay, so I try to make a picture. So it's a picture is for the prime p equal 3, for g is equal to 1. In that case, you have two components in the white space, the odd and the even component. So here is the even component, and you see that. I have plotted the. The weights there, so the classical weights, and now in this picture the classical weight get the triadic topology, and this is why you see that 0 is closer to 18 than to 2. Okay, so that's So now that I have told you what is the correct parameter space for this interpolation, I can tell you how we are going to interpolate the sheaves. So from now on, everything is p-adic. So, my Shimura variety is an algebraic variety, but I can view it as an analytic space, not over C, but over QP. Okay? And inside it, there is a very important locus, which is called the ordinary locus. Okay? And this is the locus where the universal abelian variety, so the abelian variety, has ordinary reduction. This is an open subset. Okay? And I will also need what is called the overconvergent ordinary locus, and this is somehow the limits over all the strict neighborhoods of this locus. Okay. So, the first result I want to report about is that these automorphic sheaves, okay, that we had for each algebraic weight, algebraic dominant weight, each classical weight. Now, if you restrict them to the overconvergent ordinary locus, they can be interpolated over W. Okay, so there were countably many of them, okay, one for each algebraic weight. But then, if you make this restriction to this smaller region of the Shimura variety, then you can start to vary them over the parameter space, which is the weight space. Okay? So, okay, so this is what is explained here. So I think I should try to at least give some idea of the proof of something in this talk, and so I want to give some idea of the proof of this. So what is special about the ordinary locus, and somehow why does this work? So to explain a bit the proof, I will put myself in the simplest possible setting. So I will assume that g is equal to 1. Okay, so I'm dealing with modular curves. Okay. Then, what is going to help us is a certain period mapping that we have over p-adic basis. And this period mapping is called the Hochstedt period map. And so it's a period mapping that relates two objects of different nature. So let me fix E over CP some elliptic curve. So CP is some algebraic closure of QP, but so the completion of an algebraic closure of QP. But if you are not comfortable with this, just assume we are over QP. So this period map is relates on the one side the Tate module, the p-adic Tate module of E. So this is the inverse limit over the p to the n torsion point of the elliptic curve. And so as a module, it is a free module of rank 2 over ZP. And on the other side, you have the sheaf of differentials over your elliptic curve. And this is isomorphic to CP, because an elliptic curve is one-dimensional. Okay? So, I mean, this period mapping may have some resemblance with the with some Archimedean mapping, which is the comparison between Durham and singular homology, which is like the comparison between singular homology and differential forms, but somehow this other Archimedean theorem goes in the other direction. Okay, so this period mapping is really purely p-adic, and its origin relies in the fact that maybe the group schemes of p to the nth root of unity in over p-adic basis is not ethal. It has interesting infinitesimal properties. Okay. So now you see on the left-hand side we have the rank 2 object, and on the right-hand side we have a rank 1 object. But now if we assume that the elliptic curve is ordinary, then the Tate module has more structure. It is filtered. So it is an extension of some ethal quotient, which is there. And the sub is some multiplicative sub. And each of them has now rank 1. And now what happens is that this Hochstedt period map, it becomes an isomorphism over the ordinary locus between the tensor product with CP of this ethal quotient of the Tate module of the elliptic curve. So now, what does this mean? Here you have a CP vector space of rank 1. And what it's telling us is that inside the CP vector space, there is a natural ZP vector space underlying it. So in other words, it means that the GL1 torsor, omega I, arises from a torsor under a much more smaller group, which is the group ZP star. Okay? So we say that it has the GL1 torsor omega I as a ZP star reduction. So maybe I can show you some picture of this, right? So I try to make some picture. So say on the bottom we have this is like the modular curve, okay? So this is the union of the blue thing and the green thing, okay? So the ordinary locus is the blue region, the supersingular locus this green region. And so the big black rectangle is my vector bundle omega I. Okay, so it's a GL1 torsor. And somehow, if I look away from the supersingular disk, what happens is that inside this GL1 torsor, which is one-dimensional, I have this profinite set. Okay, and so this profinite set is represented by these red lines, okay, these red strips. Okay, so that's like the picture. So now, using this, we can get the following commutative diagram. Okay, so remember, the construction of my automorphic sheaves. So I used the characters of GL1 to twist the vector bundle omega I, and then I got some automorphic sheave on my Shimura variety. So here it's just the sheaf omega k of Waitke modular form, if you know what this is. Okay, but now on that side I perform a restriction to this ordinary locus, and now instead, I can improve my functor, and somehow instead of using characters of GL1, I can now use characters of ZP star, and I can twist. Now, over the ordinary locus, I can twist my sheaf by characters of ZP star, my sheaf omega I by characters of ZP star. And the reason is because inside my sheaf omega I have a ZP star torsor. Okay, that's what I told you. Okay. So, this was known to cats in the 70s, so it's very classical, okay? Okay, but we're still not yet there, because as I told you, I don't want sheaves over the ordinary Shimura variety, but I want sheaves over this over-convergent neighborhood. And I will tell you after why this is so important. So, how can we do a bit better? So what I claim is that actually this can be improved into, so the top map remains the same, right? So characters of GL1 go to automorphic sheaves over the Shimura variety. But now I want to use, to go from characters of ZP star to p-adic automorphic sheaves over the over-convergent ordinary locus. So how is this going to be possible? So you see, if I go one slide, two slides before, this profinite set inside my omega e, so this ZP star reduction, it does not go inside the supersingular region, okay? But I want to go inside the supersingular region. So what can I do? Well, actually what I can do is that I should replace the group ZP star by a small thickening of it. So how do I thicken ZP star? So you see, you should think of ZP star as sitting inside GL1, okay? And, well, I thicken it by adding to ZP star some groups of units that are very congruent to one modulo P. And therefore, the group that now I get, the thickening of ZP star, is an extension of this finite group by a connected group, okay, which is, okay, so by these connected groups of units which are very congruent to one. Okay, and so now what happens is that the picture, if I change from my group ZP star to the thickening of the group ZP star, the picture becomes like this. Like the torsor omega I, it now has a reduction to the thickening. Namely, it means that inside the torsor of, I mean, inside my vector bundle omega I, I have this second red line, okay? But now the second red line, they go inside the supersingular locus, okay? And so this is how I can get some over convergence. Because the other thing, because the other thing is that now if I consider all the characters of ZP star, then the p-adic characters, actually, they are locally analytic. And so it means that they extend to the thickening of ZP star. And so it means that I can actually twist my bundle omega I by these locally analytic characters using this extra structure. How do we get this extra structure? It's again some refinement studying the Hochstedt period map, quite a lot. Actually, yeah, we're using some results of the next speaker, and I really want to advertise this talk. So Laurent Farc. okay. So now you see we have, okay. So now, let's summarize the thing so far. So we have these Shimura varieties, we have these automorphic sheaves, and when we restrict to neighborhoods of the ordinary locus, we can interpolate them over this white space, the parameter space, which has a nice analytic structure. So one very reasonable question is, somehow can we, at classical weights, what is the difference between the cohomology over the ordinary locus, or over-convergent ordinary locus, and the cohomology of over the full Shimura variety? And the study of this problem goes under the name of classicity theorem. So we fix some classical weight kappa. We have a restriction map between the cohomology of our Shimura variety in weight kappa to the same cohomology. So actually, I'm only considering degree zero cohomology, but okay, we'll see what to do with higher cohomology later. So this over-convergent ordinary cohomology, and so we have this restriction map. Okay, so just restrict functions, okay, from the full Shimura variety, not function, but sections of the vector bundle, to this over-convergent ordinary Shimura variety. Okay, so the left-hand side, this side, this is a nice finite-dimensional QP vector spaces, right? I mean, I'm assuming that my Shimura variety is proper or has been compactified, so I have finiteness results. Well, the right-hand side is very big, actually, because you see the ordinary locus, it's a fine. I mean, just think of the modular curves, right? So the modular curves are proper. I mean, but then if you start to remove some points in a proper curve, then you get something affine, right? And it immediately has lots of sections. So this is quite big, and it's actually an inductive limit, compact inductive limit, of Banach spaces, of infinite dimensional Banach spaces. Okay, but now both sides are equipped with an action of Ecke operators. And among all the Ecke operators, there's a natural compact operator, which I will denote by UP, and I mean, if you know the theory of modular forms, it's really the UP operator that you know. And well, when you have a compact operator, then you can do spectral theory with it. I mean, especially in the periodic world, it works absolutely well, so you can do the spectral decomposition on this side, and also on this side, but on this side it's not very hard, I mean, this is finite dimensional. And well, you can also speak of the slopes. So the slopes, this is the periodic valuation of the elements you get in the spectrum, okay, of the spectral values, okay? Okay, and so we have this theorem, which is a classicity theorem, and which goes under the name that small slope forms are classical. So this theorem was first proved by Robert Coleman in the 90s, and then reproved by Casey about 10 years later, that was for the modular curve. And with Bijakovsky and Stroh, we found like some vast generalization of this. And so it says that this map, this restriction map, it is an isomorphism on the small slope part, okay? And what is the small slope part? Well, it's a condition that's explicit on the weight. And it means that the weights have to be regular enough with respect to the slope. What does regular mean? Recall that your weight is a tuple, k1 until kg, and so regular means that the consecutive difference of any two of these numbers has to be big, and that the last one, the kg, has to be big as well. Okay, this is the definition. Okay, so now we can speak. Okay, so now let me finally construct some geometric object. Okay, so we can speak. So it is the eigenvariety. So the eigenvariety is the spectrum of the Ecke algebra which is acting on this varying cohomology, okay, over this overconvergent ordinary locus. And I can speak of the spectrum of the Ecke algebra because I have some compact operator in this Ecke algebra. And so although it's not finite dimensional, somehow I can still, I mean, we have like nice slope decomposition and everything. I mean, nice decomposition. So now what is the property? So this eigenvariety is equidimensional of dimension g. It has a weight map. So this is the weight. So I mean, this eigenvariety, it records like the system of eigenvalues you get by acting on these modules as they vary with the weight. So there is a weight map which somehow sends an eigen system to the weight in which it occurs. Okay, and this weight map has discrete fibers, infinite discrete fibers. And the classical automorphic points, they are Zariski events in this eigenvariety. So here is a picture. So you should imagine that somehow the weight space and the eigenvariety have the same dimension, also it's not very clear from the picture. And somehow, so, I mean, the thing is that if you look locally on the eigenvariety, then it doesn't look so different from the weight space. But globally, the eigenvariety is very mysterious, okay? I mean, like, the fibers are infinite, discrete but infinite, and somehow we don't even know if there are finitely many numbers of connected components and everything. I mean, it's quite a complicated object. Okay, so now here is a first topological property we can prove using all this machinery about the automorphic forms that occur in this setting. The first property we can prove is that it's always possible to go in the regular direction on the weight space. We can always make the weight more regular. So the statement is that if you start with any automorphic point x on this eigenvariety, then around it, so say it's here, then around it you can find points which are automorphic points again, which are as regular as you want. Okay, so you can always go in the regular direction. The regular direction is not obstructed at all. So now the remaining of the talk is about going into the other direction. So for this. So, okay, so in the regular direction, everything is fine. And now I want to go in the other direction, the less regular direction, and and you will see why. So you see the. So I'm going to speak about this problem. I'm going to specialize to the case that g is equal to 1, and I'm going to tell you about things about like the Eigen curve. Okay, so g is equal to 1. My Eigen variety has dimension g, so it's called the Eigen curve. And okay, so the first thing I can do. So remember that in this case, the white space is a union of open unit disk, but it has a compactification in a slightly fancy category, which is the category of analytic Hadic spaces, which is obtained by adding a finite number of points at infinity, which correspond to continuous characters of ZP star, but not P Hadic, T Hadic. So they're valued in local fields of equal characteristics. So the picture is like this. So the compactified white space is some sphere. It has a point at infinity. And when you remove this point, then you really get the open unit disk. Okay, so the theorem we proved is that all this construction of these automorphic sheaves and the Eigen curve, they actually extend to this compactified white space. And why is this compactified white space so interesting? It's so interesting because of this beautiful conjecture of Coleman, Mazur, Buzzard, and Kilford, which says that over the neighborhood of a neighborhood of this point at infinity, this Eigen curve, whose geometry is probably very complicated, admits a very simple shape. Namely, there should exist some neighborhood like this, so the pink region, such that if you look over it, then you have an infinite union of finite flat covers. Okay, so they basically look like the original space on the white space. Okay. What is known about this conjecture? There's a great theorem by Liu, Wan, and Xiao, and they prove this conjecture for certain irreducible components of the Eigen curve, namely those components that arise from Jacquet-Langlands correspondence. Okay? So, I mean, it's not for all the correspondences, but maybe you know like the Jacquet-Langlands correspondence. It allows you to switch from automorphic forms on GL2 over Q to automorphic forms on division algebra over Q under some hypothesis. And then, well, they worked with these automorphic forms, so and they managed to prove the conjecture for these Eigen curves. And somehow, these Eigen curves can be seen as irreducible components in this Eigen variety. Okay. So now, what kind of consequence do we get on the topology? Well, we get this consequence that actually the smallest regular weight in this setting, which is weight 2, the smallest regular weight the automorphic points of weight 2, of this smallest regular weight, they are Zariski dense in all these quaternionic Eigen curves, so in all these irreducible components. And of course, if we knew the conjecture for all the Eigen curves, then we would know that the weight 2 points are Zariski dense in all irreducible components. So it means that somehow if you start with any automorphic points here, then somehow you can find some path, okay, so you can like move on the component and then get to infinitely many weight 2 automorphic points, which correspond in that case to weight 2 modular points, to weight 2 modular forms, okay? And this is quite interesting because, I mean, there are things that, I mean, like modularity theorem that are much easier to prove in this setting, right? So if you, I mean, like, yeah, I mean, like, okay, like modularity lifting theorem, or so which are, I mean, so say instances of the conjecture I stated at the very beginning. So for the group GL2 over Q, or maybe GL2 over a totally real field, they're much easier to prove. I mean, it's not proven, but somehow we have better results in general for this smallest regular weight, so the weight 2. And then there is some hope that somehow this kind of result that allows you, if you start with a very regular weight, to get down to the least, to the smallest regular weight, could be used to somehow expand this modularity theorem. Okay, and I should say that there's no way you can get below weight 2. Okay, there are not enough weight 1 forms. But this is now what I want to explain. So now, let's summarize the talk. So I mean, all this talk is maybe about the topology of this automorphic forms. Okay, so automorphic forms have a weight, and I've chosen to try to vary the weight. Okay, so first thing I told you, there are these very general results that tell you that somehow it's completely unobstructed to go in the more regular region. Then for g equal 1, we have this nice result that somehow, it's conjecture that somehow you can get down to the smallest regular weight, which is 2. But now, what if we go to irregular weights? What happens? So we should look again at our classicity theorem. So our classicity theorem, it compares the classical cohomology, but its small slope part, with the cohomology over this overconvergent ordinary locus. But actually, this classicity theorem is completely empty at irregular weight. Because if the weight is irregular, this small slope condition is never satisfied. Is there some reason for this? There is a reason. The reason is that at irregular weights, there is not only one cohomology degree that is interesting. So in all my talk, it was the degree zero cohomology. But actually, there are several consecutive cohomology degrees that occur. And they all somehow play some role. And they're all also responsible for the fact that there are not so many, that there are some obstruction into finding automorphic forms of irregular weights. Okay, you maybe know that somehow we don't know the dimension of the space of weight one modular forms. Just because, if you write the Riemann-Rohr formula, you have two unknown, which is the H0 and the H1. So this difficulty, this irregularity, also reflects on the other side of my conjecture, so on the Galois theoretic side, or maybe the motivic side, that I'm dealing with motives of irregular weights, okay? And somehow this obstruction starts to really be understood, and why you should have several cohomology degrees, and etc. And so in particular, there's some great work of Calegari and Gherardi, who explained how to modify the Taylor-Wiles method to apply it in this setting. And also there's work by Venkatesh and his collaborators who somehow try to have some very, very deep explanation of this, of the appearance of these consecutive cohomology degrees explained by like the action of certain derived Dekker algebra. Okay, so maybe actually I will say something at some point about this. Okay, so let me just, illustrate this for G equal 1, okay? So for G equal 1, I've explained to you like we have some good interpolation theory of the H0 cohomology, and we get some very nice, we have some classicity theorem when the weight is regular enough, and here regular enough means large positive. Okay, large depends on the slope. Okay. Somehow this is for the modular, for modular curves, so for G equal 1, like this is a picture, so somehow you have, so the weight is here, right? So it gets increasing. And somehow, if you're starting from weight 2, you only have cohomology in 1 degree, in the H0. And then if you're below, you only have cohomology in H1. And somehow, our classicity theorem there, they're for this regular region. But now what happens if you get to weight 1? And this is what I told you. If you get to weight 1, there are two interesting cohomology degrees, the H0 and the H1. And they are actually isomorphic. Okay, so they are both interesting. They're actually isomorphic. And they correspond. And these weight one forms, they indeed correspond to irregular motifs. And these are Artin representations. So they are two-dimensional odd Artin representations whose odd state weights are 0 and 0. Okay, so this is why it's irregular. That's the meaning of irregular on the motivic side. Okay. So now let's look a bit at the picture for G equal 2. So what I've told you is some interpolation theory of the H0 of this automorphic vector bundle and with a classicity theorem for regular weights. Okay, here I've made a picture of the possible weights. So the possible weights, the weights, now what they are pair of integers and they should be dominant, which means that they should be in this region, so below the red line. And they should satisfy And what's the regularity condition? So the regularity condition means that you are like in this chamber, this chamber which is called H0. But now, in this case, there is an entire wall of irregular weight. There are several walls, but somehow there's an entire wall of irregular weights for which you really have cohomology, interesting cohomology in two consecutive degrees. So the point is that in this region of the weights, you only have interesting cohomology in degree zero. But here, over this wall, we have cohomology in two consecutive degrees. Okay, so somehow this wall is playing a role that is similar to weight one forms before, but now there are infinitely many weights on this wall. I mean, it's one dimension. Okay, so now on this wall, I mean, if we want some nice periodic theory, so we can, I mean, we have to do, we can still do something. But now we should, I mean, as I told you, there are two interesting cohomology degrees, and so we should interpolate simultaneously these two cohomology degrees. And this theory was recently constructed, okay? So it's a theory that is supported over this one-dimensional weight space, so this wall. But it takes a slightly more complicated shape, namely, you're not only interpolating one cohomology degree, but you're interpolating two cohomology degrees. And so actually what you get is a perfect complex over the weight space with amplitude 0, 1, the range in which you have cohomology. And so in situation, I mean, a perfect complex is just a complex where somehow, I mean, every term, it's bounded. I mean, there is only some complex, I mean, there is only an object in degree 0, an object in degree 1, and each are projectives, finite projective over the weight space. And but now if you pass to the actual cohomology groups, then there will in the most interesting case there will be actually torsion over the weight space, so there will be zero dimensional. And this is again an illustration of the difficulty to construct interesting automorphic forms in this region, right? I mean in this irregular weights, like somehow the topologies, I mean, there are not so many, there's an obstruction, okay? So now this theory was, I mean, it plays an important role in the following potential modularity theorem in irregular weight. And so it's a theorem that we recently obtained with Boxer, Calegari, and G. And it says that genus 2 curves over Q are potentially automorphic. So it means that they satisfy, I mean, that there's a weak version of the conjecture I stated at the very beginning. But this weak version is actually enough to imply the Hassevel conjecture for genus 2 curves over Q. So here the irregularity is that a genus 2 curve has odd numbers with multiplicity. And the relevant automorphic forms, they are on the group GSP4 over Q, and they have weight 2-2. So in my previous slide, they're exactly there on this wall. Okay? And so, I mean, it's interesting that it took more than 20 years after Weyl's theorem to go to genus 2, and this is really related with this difficulty of dealing with irregular weights and irregular automorphic forms. And I'm almost done. So I just want to finish by concluding that somehow for the moment I've spoken mostly about the interpolation of vector bundles, but actually there's much more room for interpolation. And one other thing you can do is also interpolate more algebraic structures. So for instance, differential operators on automorphic forms. So on modular curves, you have this relative Durham cohomology, which is a filtered module with a connection. So this is like the differential operator. And this is my last slide. So for all integer k, you can consider the symmetric powers of this filtered vector bundle with connection. And in a recent work, Andreata and Jovita, they constructed a universal symmetric power of this object. And they managed to somehow also construct periodic interpolation of powers of the connection. And this has application to, different branch of subject, but somehow related, which is the construction of periodic L functions. Okay. So I thank you. I just want to say, I mean, there are many colleagues and friends in the audience, and somehow, I'd like to thank them for all the works we've been doing together and for sharing ideas with such a great spirit. So thank you very much.
Questions? Look, if there are no questions, I might not even ask a stupid question. I might tell a stupid anecdote. So please ask a question.
I have a question for myself.
Yes, excellent.
So what about genus 3?
What about genus 3?
Okay. Well, I mean, so genus 3 is completely out of reach because the corresponding automorphic forms we have no incarnation, so we don't even know how to prove that they have anything algebraic. I mean, so we don't even know that somehow they are L series. When you write it down, then you see algebraic numbers. So it's, I mean, it's, maybe we should first solve the mass form of Galois-type problem before we attack genus tree.
Very well. Other questions? Yes.
On definite quaternion algebras.
Yes.
Is there a way of deforming from weight one?
No,
isn't an...
You mean, so you take a quaternion algebra which is split at infinity? Is that what you...
No, non-split at infinity.
Okay. No, but in any case, yes, so somehow you should see white one forms in it, but it's not clear because they don't naturally occur. You really have to use like the split modular. I mean, you really have to use the modular curve in order to see white one modular forms. I mean, if it's definite at infinity, somehow there's no coherent shift.
Yes, can't get it by a periodic approximation.
Yeah, you actually see them, but somehow you see them when after you prove the Jacquet-Langlands, periodic Jacquet-Langlands correspondence.
Very well. Are there any other questions? Well, if not, I will spare you the anecdote, but I will thank the speaker for having uttered the words, very classical results by Katz from the 70s. I will explain that to him privately. Let us thank the speaker for his wonderful talk.